Amen. Let's all stand as we get ready to praise the Lord.
Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Oh, 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 oh. There is singing at the ancient gates. There's a melody of ceaseless praise. Age to age, the sound is only growing stronger. There's a throne beneath the name of names. There is seated on it one who reigns, and his kingdom now is here and getting closer. Praise him like we're there in glory. Here and now he's just as holy. Jesus, he's so worthy of it all. He exists in everlasting light. So on heaven's street there is no night. Every tear is wiped away. We'll know no sorrow. Yeah, worship him with joyful sound. Oh, sing until your voice gives out. No matter where or who's around, release your worship.
In the darkness we were waiting. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you again that we get to gather together. Lord, help us to see life as the grace that it is. And in that grace, in that freedom that you've given us in Christ, help us to see the beauty of how we can live in today's world. Help us to see just how powerful you are and how awesome it is to have you as a God. and how awesome it is to be able to do what we just did a little bit ago, to bring our requests to you, to make our requests known to you. Help us to see how powerful that is and that we can ask you anything, Lord. And we just ask right now, Lord, that you lead and guide throughout this entire message, that you speak. That we don't need to hear from me. We hear from me enough here. We need to hear from you, Lord. So we just love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, church. So we are continuing our sermon series in the book of Joshua this morning called Bound for the Promised Land. The Israelites were promised in the Abrahamic covenant. That's the fancy way of saying the covenant that God made with Abraham, that they would have numerous descendants in the land of Israel. That is the land of Canaan. That land includes modern-day Israel, but the boundary extends far beyond just the present nation's borders. So we too, when we think of the promised land, we can think of a type as the new heavens and the new earth to come that we will know when Jesus comes again in glory. Amen? What a wonderful day that's going to be. There'll be no more sin. And also, there's no Amorites or Canaanites to deal with in the kingdom to come, which is good news. No battles to be fought in the next life. So Joshua is all about God's faithfulness. I'm talking about the book here. It's his faithfulness, his fulfillment of promises, his being with his people wherever they go. Amen? It's good news. He's with us wherever we go. And so last week, Pastor Adam, he spoke on the Gibeonites. And the Gibeonites are kind of a funny tribe. They're tricky people. They deceived the Israelites into making a covenant with them, pretending that they weren't from Canaan. But they were. And so the Israelites made a hasty oath with these folks without seeking the counsel of God. That seems to be the lesson. So while we don't need to get silly in seeking God's will with some choices, you might not think this is silly. Like, oh, Lord, should I drink a Coke or a Pepsi? Oh, Lord, should I have a chocolate chip or cookie dough? And that might get kind of silly, and it's not going to impress your spiritual friends. But it's better at the same time to err on the side of leaning into his wisdom over going with our gut feeling, okay? My gut tells me, your gut can be wrong. My gut can be wrong, okay? Even though maybe your gut's good. Maybe you got a good gut. I'm not talking about like the probiotic type gut, okay? I'm talking about like your feelings. Feelings can deceive, okay? They can be good too, and they can be right. They can confirm, but they can also deceive. And so we should not place our trust in feelings, but in the solid foundation of God's word and his promises. So something can feel very wrong, but end up, or feel very right, I should say, and end up being very wrong. There was a pop song, I haven't listened to pop in a long time, but it was like, oh, there it is, that's depravity. I feel so wrong doing the right thing. I feel so right doing the wrong thing. That is how feelings can deceive. And so we need to ask God for everything. We need to ask God for wisdom, but we need to ask him for everything. So speaking of asking God, the sermon title for this morning is Ask God. He can do it. Amen? He can do it. So brothers and sisters, what do you believe? This is the question. What do we believe that God is capable of doing? Have you asked him for what you need lately? Have you still came to him with your needs? You can just live life by the gut. We pray for our needs almost every week here at church, and truthfully, we cannot spend too much time doing it. We need to bring our needs to God. So do we realize how powerful God is? Do we realize how awesome he is? That word really does only belong to God. In Joshua 10, which is the passage for this morning, I'm not going to read the whole thing today, five kings are going to join forces against the Gibeonites for joining Israel. In the mind of the Canaanites, these are deceivers turned covenanted believers. And so we're going to see these folks actually calling for aid from Israel. So God has been winning the battles of this campaign for Canaan this entire way. And so the question arises, because it's been pretty creative in approaches in weeks prior, how's he going to do it this time? So if you haven't already, go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Joshua 10, and we're going to read the first 15 verses together. Let's see what happens here. Very, very amazing passage. Joshua 10. As soon as, and forgive me for the name pronunciations. As soon as Adonizedek, king of Jerusalem, heard how Joshua had captured Ai, that's a city, that's not artificial intelligence, captured Ai and had devoted it to destruction, doing to Ai and its king as he had done to Jericho and its king, and now the inhabitants of Gibeon had made peace with Israel and were among them, he feared greatly because Gibeon was a great city, like one of the royal cities, and because it was greater than Ai, and all its men were warriors. So Adonizedek, king of Jerusalem, sent Hoham, king of Hebron, to Piram, king of Jarmuth, to Japhia, king of Lachish, and to Deber, king of Eglon, saying, come up to me and help me, and let us strike Gibeon, for it has made peace with Joshua and with the people of Israel. Then the five kings of the Amorites, the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, the king of Jarmuth, the king of Lachish, and the king of Eglon gathered their forces and went up with all their armies and camped against Gibeon and made war against it. And the men of Gibeon sent to Joshua at the camp in Gilgal, saying, do not relax your hand from your servants. Come to us quickly and save us and help us, for all the kings of the Amorites who dwell in the hill country are gathered against us. So Joshua went up from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of valor. And the Lord said to Joshua, do not fear them, for I've given them into your hands. Not a man of them shall stand before you. And so Joshua came upon them suddenly, having marched up all night from Gilgal. And the Lord threw them into a panic before Israel, who struck them with a great blow at Gibeon and chased them by the way of the ascent of Beth-horon and struck them as far as Azekah and Makkedah. And as they fled before Israel, while they were going down the ascent of Beth-horon, the Lord threw down large stones from heaven on them as far as Azekah, and they died. There were more who died because of the hailstones than the sons of Israel killed with the sword. At that time, Joshua spoke to the Lord in the day when the sun gave the Amorites over to the sons of Israel, and he said in the sight of Israel, sun, stand still at Gibeon, and moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stopped, until the nation took vengeance on their enemies. Is this not written in the book of Jashar? The sun stopped in the midst of heaven and did not hurry to set for about a whole day. There has been no day like it before or since, when the Lord heeded the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. So Joshua returned, and Israel with him, to the camp at Gilgal. The word of the Lord, pretty amazing. Never had there been a day like this, the Bible says. Quite a spectacular day. And so from a military perspective, Joshua and Israel have now put basically a rectangle shape into the heart of Canaan. They're in the north and the south. They've divided it. So they're in a really good position to start taking the southern kingdom. And that's what we're going to see play out. So in verse 1, we see the mention of this king, this first perpetrator, Adonizedek. You know any Adonizedeks today? Probably not. But this name, it's kind of funny, but it's not funny, but it's kind of funny, you know, that kind of thing. The name means king of righteousness, okay? This is not great people. We've talked about that before. We'll get into that in a minute. But this is a Jebusite name. Adonizedek is the king of, this is also another, now this name you're more familiar with. He's the king of Jerusalem, okay? This is the first mention of this name, this holy city in the Bible, and it was not inhabited in a very holy way here at all. The king hears that Gibeon had made a covenant with Israel, and so because of this, verse 2, it says it right there, he feared greatly. He was right to do so, but wrong in how he approached it. He feared greatly because Gibeon was a great city. And what kind of people lived in Gibeon? Its men were warriors. Ai had fallen. Jericho had fallen. Gibeon was taken without a fight. In some ways, it was like, here you go, Israel. And so there was great fear in the heart of the king of Jerusalem. And so this is the city of warriors that's been taken captive by the enemy. That's not very encouraging. So a city of friendly pacifists, or maybe a city of scholarly intellectuals, that would be okay to come up against, but a city of warriors is not a fun thought to think of attacking. And so, as often happens when one feels betrayed, the vengeance felt by this king and his mates is doubled toward the turncoats, toward the people who switch sides, so to speak. And so they feel betrayed by their fellow Canaanites, and Adonizedek sends word to his four buddies, four kings in their territory. So we got five kings in total here again. And verse 4 says, come on, let's go. We're going to attack Gibeon. We're going to go get him. I don't know if you heard about it, but they made peace with Joshua. And this is not good for any of us. It's not just me. It's not good for any of you either. Let's go get them. And so tactically, again, they have good reason to be upset because of where this is placed. Royal city, strong city. And so since Israel had gained control of Gibeon, they were in a great spot now. Great spot to start dividing up the promised land that God had given them. From a military perspective, it's going great. And so here come all the kings, probably all their horses and all their men along with them, preparing to attack Gibeon. And so we're used to seeing in weeks prior that there is a slight difference here. The Canaanites rising up against who? The Israelites. But this is different. Now they're gathering against their own, Israel's newest allies. These are Canaanites coming against Canaanites. Israel didn't know what they would have with this ally, especially after the tricky deception that they used in order to make peace with Israel, because they were afraid of God in another way. But God, as often he does, used this sloppy mess for good. Amen? He used this weird trick by these people who won the Oscar of the Year, tricking the Israelites, for the good of his people. And so even when we make mistakes or mess up, and sometimes even when we, quite frankly, I'll just say it direct, sometimes when we do something stupid, God can use that for good. Now, I've never done anything stupid, but I know a lot of you have, so. And now we just praise God for his grace that I'm still standing here. I've definitely done my share of stupid. All right. Now, they're gathering against their own. And so even when we make mistakes or mess up, God can use it for good. And so when we think of that verse that's usually found in Hallmark cards or whatever, for we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28. That doesn't say just the good stuff. That's the good stuff and the bad stuff. All of it. It's hard to believe, but it's a wonderful promise. And so a friend of God, an ally of the Almighty, won't take long, find themselves an enemy of the world. And so the five kings, verse 5, gathered their forces, went up with all their armies, and camped against Gibeon and made war against it. It's not looking good for the Gibeonites. They have heard of what Yahweh has done for Israel, right? I think this is what I heard about the Jordan and Jericho and Ai, but they had not seen his power for themselves. They were about to. And our God, the only God, is an awesome God. Amen? And so that brings me to the first point. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That is a direct quote, depending on your translation, of Ephesians 6:10. Ephesians 6:10. And the passage proceeds to tell us to put on what? Do you know what's in Ephesians 6? The full armor of you? No, the full armor of God. And so we got to think about this. Why his armor? Why not mine? I mean, I can get pretty suited up nowadays. Because your armor, your tools, your ability, it's not that kind of armor, and it's not capable of what God's armor can do. Okay? So we have no power in ourselves against the devil and his enemies. You know that? You're like, hey, devil, bring it on. By the power of Hank, we're going to go. No, Hank's going to get his butt beat. That's the lightest way I can say it. But in God's armor And it says in Ephesians 6:11, we can stand against the schemes of the devil. It's not up to me. It's God's power. So the belt of truth, the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness, feet that carry the good news of the gospel, which is beautiful, the Bible says, the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. It's all about walking in the power of His might, not mine. Amen? It's good news. There are battles we can't win in our might, but God can win every battle He chooses. He's undefeated. And so can you command the host of heaven? Can you tell angels what to do? I can't. Can you make kings bow down before you? No. But God can. And even Jesus is called the ruler of the kings of the earth, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He will reign. And He is reigning. So, we serve a holy God. He sits in the heavens. He rules over space and time, from the celestial to the personal, from Mars to the molecule, from cosmic wonders to intimate relationships. God is in command of it all. Every single bit of it. There's not an atom outside of God's control. And so He has an awesome power. That's why He's called the Almighty. That's why you might have heard the name El Shaddai. That's Almighty God. He is all-powerful. El Shaddai means most powerful. And so Israel had this revealed to them about their God, but and they believed it perfectly all the time, right? No. No. They were prone to forgetting, and it was obvious based on how they behaved. And so Gibeon had heard of it, but to the extent of how much they believed it, we don't know that. But we too can know a lot of things about God, and that doesn't mean that we're believing Him in the present moment. Okay? Somebody said in Sunday school this morning, in Kathy's class, they said, what's the unpardonable sin? It's a kind of a controversial passage, right? I'm not going to give you a verbatim answer on that this morning, but I will tell you the one sin that keeps people out of heaven and sends them to hell. There's one sin. Unbelief. Unbelief will send you the other way, because there's no other name by which we must be saved but by the name of Jesus Christ. It's not all who do a bunch of great things for me. It's all who believe in my name. Amen? And yes, if you are, somebody said blasphemy, yeah, we can talk about that too. If you are walking in unbelief, you will be blasphemous too. So there's multiple layers to this. But anyway, faith is active. Gibeon calls on Israel in this moment of crisis. And you can just read the crisis in verse 6. It's like jumping off the page. Do not relax your hand from your servants. Come to us quickly. Save us. Help us. The kings of the Amorites who dwell in the hill country are gathered against us. Save us, Joshua. Save us. That's redundant, by the way. They probably didn't realize that. But that was redundant to say, save us, Joshua, as it's redundant to say, save us, Jesus. Because Joshua means, God is my salvation. It means God saves, just as Jesus means God saves. Names matter in the Bible. And granted, the names that God gives are more to gather our attention, unlike the names like Adonai, Zedek. I want to say Adonai. Something in me wants to say Adonai. I doubt that's what it is. Adonizedek, whose name means king of righteousness, but clearly doesn't fit. And so now, did Joshua have to answer that call? We don't know. I don't know either. But Jesus didn't have to save us. Did you know that? There is nothing that binds God to offer salvation to anyone. It's a free gift. And Jesus chose to save us because He is salvation. He is the gospel. Joshua honored the oath. And so again, side note, before we get into the battle scene, you know, God throwing stones down at people, it's pretty rough. The Amorites were not good people. And I don't mean that to say, like, here's the good people, here's the bad people. We all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's not what I mean by that. But I mean this society was very base, okay? I won't get into it again, but human sacrifice, bestiality, all kinds of stuff. War is bloody, but evidently, because God ordained it, in a fallen world, war is sometimes necessary, okay? So Joshua leaves Gilgal. He's taking these mighty men with him. And so I got to thinking about this, but how do you personally, brother, sister, how do you feel about repeat encouragements? Somebody say, hey, brother, it's going to be all right. Do you not want them to say that again? Like, is any part of you like, you already said that, don't say it again? I don't think so. I think usually, and especially if we need encouragement, we're usually like, I don't feel like it. It's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. It's okay to repeat an encouragement because God repeats encouragement to his people all the time. And so in verse 8, this looks like a repeat. Joshua, do not fear them, for I have given them into your hands. Not a man of them shall stand before you. Do not fear. Do not be afraid. Most frequent command in the Bible, do not be afraid. We are prone to being scared. Joshua was no different, even though he's a great man of God. Prone to being scared. God's got this, Joshua. God reassures him several times during this campaign, and he reassures us through word and spirit today. So in today's world, I'll take encouragement anytime. And so brother and sister, just hear me. The Lord is with you. That's encouraging. Amen. The Lord is with you. I don't know what your circumstance is. God does. And he can help you a lot more than I can. The Lord is with you. So, here we go. We're going to get into the battle. Verse 9. So Joshua came upon them suddenly, having marched up all night from Gilgal. And the Lord threw them into a panic before Israel. Threw them into a panic. So wait, God is sovereign. I'm good with the mountains and the molecules, but now we're talking about emotions, right? Wait, you mean God can throw somebody into a panic? Yes, he can also give them great peace. Isn't that amazing? God can cause panic or he can grant peace. And so the difference is, are you with him? Are you with him? You got to ask yourself. It's not like, hey, I'm going to pull God over to my side. It's, I need to get myself over on God's side, wherever that is. And so we're going to see in these verses, despite the mention of warriors, that God is the primary warrior, okay? God is a warrior too. He gets the victory. He fights the battle. When Jesus comes back again, how's he going to come back, church? As just, hey, shepherd, meek and mild kind of guy? No, conquering, warrior, king. And so we get to share in that victory. He gets the victory, amen? We get to share in that victory with him. That's awesome. And so Psalm 24:8 says it great. He says, it says, who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. God is master over the battlefield. He's even master over our emotions. Incredible. Verse 11 gives us something miraculous. It's an important detail. They fled before Israel. While they were going down the ascent of Beth Horon, the Lord threw down large stones from heaven, and they died. And the Bible goes the extra mile and tells us there were more who died because of the stones than the sons of Israel killed by the sword. More enemies were felled by hailstone than by sword. So what that's supposed to tell us there is that God is the one who pushed the battle in their favor. Okay, and some of you might be thinking right now, how in the world that the hailstones only hit the Amorites? Because God's that good. I could say some things, but I won't. But God sovereignly did this in a way to where he would not harm his people, but he still dealt with their enemies. And so, another thing, by the way, this was the time of this was in the summer. So hail was completely, it never happened this time of year. In the winter months, it could happen maybe up to four times. In a bad year, four times. But in the summer, never. Never. And the significance of that is, it's like, because you're like, why is he getting so creative? Like, why hailstones? What? Because a lot of these people, especially like Babylonians, Assyrians, Hittites, they believed that these elements were on their side. They thought, by their gods, that the stones are going to come and get you. And imagine the being weighed and measured in this way. I thought those stones were on my side. Now they're coming for me. That's what's going on. And so, now, some folks, they come to this passages like this, the part that I'm about to say, and they want to explain away the miraculous, all right? I don't think I have that much of a problem here at Liberty Church with you guys believing that God can do whatever he wants, amen? But let me tell you what we mean here. So verse 12, Joshua spoke to the Lord in that day when the Lord gave the Amorites over to the sons of Israel. He says this, "Sun, stand still at Gibeon, and moon in the valley of Ajalon." And so this seems to be communicating that time, some element of time stopped, or some rotation stopped. And I'm going to comment on that more in a bit. But the book of Jashar, by the way, is this not written in the book of Jashar? It's not a canonical book. If you go on Google or Amazon and, like, I'm going to order the book of Jashar and find this, it's not. The actual book is not in existence anymore. It's passed away. It's a book of ancient writings, poems, and such, Hebrew literature. But the book of Jashar that you would probably find if you Googled is not that, this book. So don't play that game. So here's the issue. Some folks want to label this miraculous event as simply poetic or symbolic. And so this is one of those passages where we actually test ourselves on that question of what we actually believe this God is capable of. Okay? So say a lot about us. Do we believe that God is El Shaddai? Do we believe that he is Almighty? If we can believe that God is God by name, then we shouldn't have any problem believing he can stop time or a sun cycle or whatever. So this is hard. The sun cycle, the earth's rotation, time itself is observationally fixed, okay? It doesn't tend to shift. And so Maddie shared that dad joke with me last week that is actually really prevalent to the sermon, which says, "I like to think about the earth's rotation. It really makes my day," right? Ha, ha, ha. Well, the day wasn't made here, okay? So that joke wouldn't have made sense on this day. But here, the sun doesn't move from its position. And I'm going to talk about the position of the sun for a moment, okay? And this is actually pretty cool and kind of wild, but just hang with me. But as far as thinking that this is a problem for God, these elements or whatever, like the sun, moving the moon, do you remember what happened with King Hezekiah? Do you remember King Hezekiah? He was ill. He was about to die. He was requesting the Lord to heal him. He's weeping. He had a problem. And so what did he do when he had a problem? Oh, man, this is it. No, he asked God to help. God, I need you. And so he stopped looking down at his problem. He started looking up to God. And we can actually see what happens in the Bible. We have this. So 2 Kings 20, 5 through 11. 2 Kings 20, 5 through 11. I'm going to get a drink of water. "Go back, tell Hezekiah, the ruler of my people, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I've heard your prayer. I've seen your tears. I will heal you. On the third day from now, you will go up to the temple of the Lord. I will add 15 years to your life. I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria. I will defend the city for my sake and for the sake of my servant David." Then Isaiah said, "Prepare a poultice of figs." They did so, applied it to the boil, and he recovered, some kind of boil tumor. Hezekiah had asked Isaiah, "What will be the sign that the Lord will heal me and I will go up to the temple of the Lord on the third day from now?" Check out this sign, guys. This is the Lord's sign to you that the Lord will do, that he has promised. "Shall the shadow go forward 10 steps, or should it go back 10 steps? It's a simple matter," Hezekiah says, "for the shadow to go forward 10 steps, because that's the progression of time." And what we're talking about here is a sundial, by the way. Something similar, maybe not exactly a sundial, but something very similar in tracking the time, like a sundial. And so it's a simple matter for the dial to go forward, make it go back 10 steps. And so the prophet Isaiah called on the Lord, and the Lord made the shadow go back 10 steps from what it had gone down the stairway of Ahaz. That means that God moved the position of the sun backward in time. That would, and based on the position here, that would have backed it up 5 hours. So imagine if it was morning, and then it's afternoon, and you're done with your coffee, unless you're like me, and then it's morning again. That's what this looked like from their perspective. And so this isn't a problem for God, okay? That's what we need to remember. This isn't a problem for God. It's his sun, it's his moon, it's his stars. He put it all there anyway. And so God heard the request of Hezekiah. Don't gloss over that too fast, okay? He heard the request of Hezekiah, and he listened. Because the prophecy that Hezekiah got was, you're done. It's over. You're about to die. And Hezekiah prayed, and he got 15 years of his life back. Do you bring your needs to God? Do you tell him what you need, working off that gut? Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything. Just like the armor of God is different than putting on, say, chainmail, prayer is a powerful tool in the saint's belt. It's not because the power, and people get so work bent out of shape about this. It's real quite simple. It's not that the power is in the person praying, or that the power lies with us, but because the prayer is invoking, it's requesting to tap into God's power, okay? All of it is God's power. And so that brings us to the second point. I love this quote. And I got encouraged by this quote. He that taught me to pray has thereby bound himself to answer prayer. You know, this is so good. I found this in one of Charles Spurgeon's sermons. And it's so good that even in his sermon it was quoted. So it's like Pastor Lon says, I feel like Charles Spurgeon even said, like I always say, he that taught me to pray has thereby bound himself to answer prayer. So God has told us to take our needs to him in prayer. Prayer is God's idea. He came up with that too. And he chooses to answer our prayers. Never will you find the Bible telling you to rest in your own ability. Never will you find that. You won't find in your Bible. If you look for God helps those who help themselves, which word is that scripture at? It's not in there. It's not in there. But you will find several instances of the Word of God telling you to rest in his power, his strength, his might. When I am weak, he is strong. Hezekiah prayed for health, got the 15 years back. Joshua asked the sun to stop, and it did. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. It's the scripture. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. The prayer of a righteous person is what? Powerful, effective. So what happened with the sun in Joshua 10? This is kind of fun, all right? There's two views on this. The more popular view is that Joshua caused the sun to stand still in the middle of the day, like bright, shining sun in all its radiance, and so that would prolong them to finish this battle until it was over. And so the end of verse 13 seems to provide a good argument for that, since it does say that the sun did not hurry to set or to go down for about a whole day. So set and down, I'm going to tell you, that word is actually not in there. Like in the actual Hebrew, the word is not there. But when we think of the sun setting, we think of it going down. But think about this. There's actually a pretty good argument that Joshua prayed. Check this out. Joshua prayed that the sun would stay down. that it would be dark, okay? And so there would be a prolonged period where the sun did not rise. And so you're already, if your ears are perking up, good, good. So the support for this is in the word stand still. The Greek word of stand still means to be silent, to go dumb, to stop doing the effect that you do, essentially. Don't work that way anymore. So to not have an effect when talking about the sun, what would that mean? What does the sun do? The sun shines. So to go silent for the sun would mean to cease shining. Also, locations matter, right? Locations matter. To stand still at Gibeon means the sun would have been in the east, and Ajalon, the valley, would have been in the west. And so since verse 9 tells us this was a surprise attack, this very well could have been an appeal for the light not to shine until the battle has been won. So what I mean by that, if we're thinking perspective here, if the sun was to stand still in Benton and the moon to be in Willisville, from where we are, that would tell you, would be able to quickly find out that I'm talking about morning, right? It's not happened yet. The sun is over that way. Rises in the east, sets in the west. Not hard, not rocket science. But that's the position of Gibeon. So Gibeon would have been in the east, Ajalon in the west, which would mean, since Joshua attacked at night, that the sun was probably not risen. Now, you're looking at your word, you're looking at your Bible, and you're saying, you have taken some kooky pills today. And that's okay, because I'm going to tell you, there's two views on this for a reason. And you don't have to adopt that view. And I didn't even know about that view until this past week. But I thought, that's really cool. And it gets into the Hebrew a little bit more. And so whichever view you take, either it was shining so they could win, or it was silent, it was not shining so they would win. The Israelites, it helped them get their victory. And by the way, it can't be an eclipse. If you take the darkness view, it can't be an eclipse. The literally moon and the sun are on opposite sides of the spectrum here. And so, anyway, moving on. Next verse. This has been in my heart a lot this week. I feel like we can abuse these verses, but then I feel like we can also underemphasize verses like this. So, verse 14. There has been no day like it before or since when the Lord heeded the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. Never been a day like it since the book of Joshua was written, but also very special day, very unique day. There's never been anything like this. So I find it wild that this verse is even in the Bible, honestly. But it's here. The Lord heeded the voice of a man. Now, I'm going to tell you what that doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that God has a will and you have a will, and you, in your will, have now superseded and taken the will of God away and now proceeded to have God emote your will and not his. It does not mean that, because that would contradict, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That's not what this means. But, on the other hand, we shouldn't overcorrect and find that this isn't amazing from our perspective. So we tend to put people like Elijah, Joshua, we tend to put them on spiritual pedestals, to say the least. After all, their names are in the Bible. Ours aren't. Hezekiah, one of the greatest kings of Israel. Israel had a lot of bad kings, okay? A lot of bad kings. But all these people, the point of James's letter when he talks about Elijah praying and the rain stopping, he says, he had a nature like ours. He had a nature like ours. He doesn't say, Elijah was really, really cool and you're not. He said, his nature's like ours. So God was with Joshua in a very special way, and he was with Elijah in a special way. I'm not taking away from that, but the power that was in these men was not in the men themselves. The power was in God, and God was using them in a special way. And so the gospel is what? It's the power of God unto salvation, which is why the Philippian jailer was told, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What's the power? The power is in the gospel. So the response is, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. There's power in the message, and the power is from God. And so we have to ask ourselves if we believe it. If you believe that God is capable of doing all these things, do you ask him like you believe that? Do you have needs? I have needs. And sometimes the Bible's right. We have not because we ask not. Very possible. How's the prayer life? How's the prayer life? I hope that it goes beyond the Sunday morning gathering. I really do. Because there's so much more to offer in the Christian life on this side of glory than to spend our weeks only thinking about God for an hour and a half. It should not be so. So John 14, 13 says this. Jesus is speaking to his disciples. I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Whatever you ask in my name, in Jesus' name. How many know there's power in the name of Jesus? Life-saving, resurrecting power. We are more than conquerors through the King who can conquer not only Canaan, but he can conquer your heart. He can conquer your emotions. The Bible says the King's heart is in the hand of the Lord, like rivers of water, he turns it whichever way he wants. You can't tell me that if he can't turn the King's heart, that he can't turn yours. God is sovereign. And so, this is how we should fight our battles. Our problems or whatever, if we remember this, we got to remember what kind of God we serve. God can stop the sun. God can prolong life. There is absolutely nothing outside of the scope of his power. Nothing. There's no molecule or atom that one got away, and that one was apart from God's will, and everything else is still in accordance with it. No. And so you look at Matthew 7. Matthew 7, 7 through 8. Many of you know this passage from the Sermon on the Mount. Ask, it will be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock, the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. The one who knocks, the door will be opened. Do you believe it? Seriously. Do we believe that God is capable to answer our requests? Folks get discouraged in their prayer life because, well, they think sometimes, well, God doesn't give me what I want. And so now I'm discouraged. I prayed for something and it didn't happen the way I thought it should. So he must not hear my prayer. Wrong. That's not true. And we shouldn't get discouraged even if the answer is not yet or no. Especially if we're active in prayer, because the Bible doesn't say, you can't point me to the scripture that says, ask me for stuff and I'll give it to you. Ask me for stuff, I'll give you whatever you want. It's not Aladdin, okay? That's not God. The Bible says, Psalm 37, verse 4, says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. One predication there. Delight in the Lord. The more we delight in God, the more we stop asking only for the stuff we want. We have the wisdom to ask for what we need. Okay? You need wisdom sometimes to ask for what you need. And so that's even something you can ask God. God, how can I ask? What should I ask for? Maybe you're not getting it because you're asking for the wrong thing too. So I'm not saying he will do whatever you request, but he can. And he very well might. Okay? We have to take our requests to him. So before you know it, and after talking to God, after praying, you might be able to say, look at what the Lord has done. Look at what the Lord has done. Because we believe that he can do what he says he can do. He that taught me to pray has thereby bound himself to answer prayer. And in some situations, I think, in my personal opinion, I think God is more willing to answer our prayers than we're willing to pray them. You know, you understand? I think that God is more willing to answer our prayers than we are willing to pray them. He will not invite me to knock in vain. Spurgeon used the example of a knocker when speaking of Christ. You know what I'm talking about? A knocker? Maybe some of you still got those. Nowadays, we usually just ring, you know, notify someone you're there with a doorbell, or you knock on the door with your hands. Good old fist. It's a job done. There's some old-fashioned exterior doors that still have that little thing hanging on them in the front. Who's got a knocker? There we go. You go, you are crossing generational lines with the knocker. Use the knocker! I can't hear you. You use the knocker to alert a resident that you're at the door. And so to the one who knocks, the Bible says, the door will be open. But you got to knock. And so Jesus' name, here's what you got, here's the illustration. Jesus' name is the name through which God receives our requests. Just like a knocker or a doorbell or whatever you use to alert a host that you are at their residence, that is how you get in. And so his name, whatever you ask in my name, that's what Jesus said. His name is the only way that we can approach the throne of grace. So if you know him, he knew you first of all. If you know him, he knew you first. If you know him, you call upon his name. You use the knocker. You use what he's told you to use. And that knocker will be like a divine signal that doesn't just come out of your mouth or in your head. It will actually resound to the most holy place of heaven itself. Your prayers are heard. The Lord hears our prayers, and those who know the Son know the Father. And you've got a good, good Father. God can be more willing to answer our prayers than we can be willing to take our prayers to him. We need to take our requests to God, and so today that's what we're going to do. The worship team, if you can come on up for a moment. Today we're doing things a little different. It's okay, and I pray that this word actually informs us. We respond to the word in faith right here, okay? No matter how far out the request sounds. So I'm going to invite you right now, if you have a prayer request, I want you to stand. If you have a prayer, if you don't feel like standing, don't. Raise your hand. Because I would love to pray for you. And I know there's some people that would love to pray for you and do exactly what we've been talking about here. After that, we're going to sing. And so we're going to respond to God today through praise and prayer. And so let us ask God to meet our needs and know by faith that he can do anything we ask in Jesus' name. Let's use that knocker. So if you're feeling led to pray for any of the folks standing, let's go ahead and go to them now. You're already standing, you raise your hand. Good back here? I want you to pray silently where you're at, guys, then we'll come together, okay? Gracious Father, first of all, impress upon us that we can do this at any time. Any time. We can boldly approach your throne in our times of need. God, help us to see just how awesome you are and realize that we don't find ourselves in situations apart from your will. Bible says that our steps, we might plan our way, but you, Lord, establish our steps. God, the Bible is filled with miraculous things. Help us to realize that you are the same God, yesterday, today, and forever. And if we glean anything from men like Hezekiah or Joshua or Elijah, let us glean that these were mighty men of God, that they were they had integrity before you, but we have a nature like theirs. And it's not some spiritual elite. Remind us that the ground is level at the foot of the cross. And so, God, if you can, you created everything in existence, from the sun to the stars, to from the mountains to the molecules. Everything has been created by your grace. Everything has been created for your glory. And so if God, help us to, I just ask first that, again, that you grant us faith. Faith. Help us to believe. Help us to believe you more. Help us to stand on your promises. Help us to believe, if my God can part the Jordan, if my God can bring down the walls of Jericho, if he can stop the rain, if he can move the sun into strange positions or move the light back, help us to realize that he can help us with our little problems and our bigger problems. And help us to see just how diminutive every problem is in light of your glory and your power. And so, God, we know you're the great physician. We know you can heal. And I know in this room right now, God, that a lot of people are asking you for healing, either for themselves or for a loved one, family member, somebody. God, you've done it before. And there are many people here that can testify of it. So give us the faith, God, that whatever may come, but before that, we just pray in the name of Jesus, the knocker by which you told us to knock. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would grant healing to all those in need through the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, for those struggling, we pray that they realize how deep, how wide, how awesome is your love. No matter where they were last night, no matter where they've been the last 5 years, no matter where they were 20, God, grant peace. You are the Prince of Peace too. And so help us to know that if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive. We pray healing for Franklin County. We pray healing for our church and for our community, whether emotional or physical pain. Help us to feel that freedom that comes from knowing you, Lord, through Jesus Christ. And so we thank you that we can do this. Help us to see just how awesome you are, day in and day out. And we lay our requests at your feet, knowing that you will give us whatever we need. In that mighty name of Jesus, amen. God is good. All the time. If you were standing, you need to stand again. Because we're going to sing now.
Commands all the host of heaven. Who else commands?
Same yesterday, today, and forever, and he invites us in, guys. I want you to see that it's an invitation, okay, into life, seeing life in a manner that is true, that is good, and even beautiful, because Christ, Jesus Christ, guys, is altogether lovely. Some of y'all are thinking right now, you know what else is lovely? When they throw that 100-yard pass from one end zone to the other. And that's okay. I want you to have a good time. It also, we also get to live with the perspective that every good and perfect gift comes from God. Amen? So I want you all to enjoy your Sunday. Have a great day. We love you. Thanks for coming. Good grief. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. Go in peace in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and pray for the mental stability of your pastor. Thank you.